I know too, so.
So, good morning, everybody, or good afternoon. I'm Nicola Seriani from the ACTP. I'm chairing today's session. So it's my pleasure to welcome Professor Robert Schlögl from the Fritz Haber Institute of the Max Planck Society. So he's an expert in catalysis. He studied at the Ludwig Maximilians University in Munich and spent some years between Cambridge and Switzerland. And now he is director at the Fritz Haber and also founding director of the Max Planck Institute for Chemical Energy Conversion. So, and he's so well known that he has a number of honorary professorships and awards, including the Annie Award for Energy Transition and the Arvin Mittasch Prize of the German Catalysis Society. So, Professor Schlögl, the screen is yours. Thank you.
All right. Good morning, everyone, here and outside. Thanks for the kind introduction, and also thanks for the opportunity to contribute to this very interesting series of lectures. I have skipped the introduction largely to what we are going to do, because there are so many excellent lectures on this that I can go straight into the details of what I want to tell you. So it's on operando photo emission from electrified interfaces, and there is only one motivation slide that I have after my acknowledgments. Of course, the acknowledgement is to the group, because I'm doing nothing rather than entertaining you, and the group is doing the work. There are a few postdocs who I'm mentioning here who have essentially contributed the work that I'm going to report to you. These are the names of my group leaders who operate the whole thing here that you see with these many people. And I would like to, in particular, mention also Peter Strasser and his team, but he will be also on this conference later, as I have seen in the program, so that is not necessary to go any more deeper in here. So what are we going to discuss about? We talk about electrified interfaces, and it is enough to say these are the critical science elements in our energy transition, because however you deal it, whatever you want to do with renewable energy, you will not be able to do anything if you don't understand what electrified interfaces are. The traditional concept that we have is very similar to heterogeneous catalysis. You have a solid liquid, or usually a solid liquid interface, and the solid is considered as being static, and there's a liquid atlayer that is of course dynamical. There's an electrical potential drop across this interface, and that reaches from the interface into the liquid, and there's the double layer concept, and that is also something that is heavily discussed on this meeting, so I do not need to go any deeper here. And what I mention only here is that it's identical in fuel cells, electrolyzers, and accumulators. So you can also study the same thing everywhere. And ideally, of course, you would like to know also the operando experiments from all these three units, but what I'm going to concentrate on is just on the electrolyzer part. The capacity that you get when you have such an interface, because there's two half reactions, is of course well detectable. We don't have to discuss this, but the chemical nature of the interface, to what this capacity relies to, that is a matter of debate. And this is one of the motivations why it is good to do operando experiments, because we are interested indeed in the interface, and we are interested in the top atomic layer, where this charge that you put on the system is actually seeing the other phase. And one hypothesis that I want to bring forward to you is, could it be that the interface is not rigid and is gradually changing its chemistry in order to accommodate the potential drop, rather than there is a potential drop only into the liquid? There could be, of course, also a potential drop in the solid, and the solid could change under reaction conditions. Now, in particular, from theory side, you would say this is possibly not the case, because, for example, you have an oxide or a metal, and in the limit that there is no chemical conversion, you would not see why that should change its chemistry. But I would like to draw your attention to the point that you have seen, and you will see also in other presentations from this conference, that we want to do, of course, production there. And if we do production, then we are far away from equilibrium. So we look into non-equilibrium states of the system, and then it is not so clear what the chemistry is. Only to illustrate the first sentence that I have on this slide is, when you look at this this diagram, then you see whatever you want to use as a potential fuel, you will always have this interface between green electrons and green molecules. And if you want to switch between green electrons and green molecules, then these electrified interfaces are the critical part of it. And that is the reason why it is very, very worthwhile that we really have a deep understanding of how that works. So now we look into polymer electrolyte electrolyzers. This is my example here. We could also use another example. We're also working on other electrolyzers. In fact, we do our larger experiments not with PEM electrolyzers, but that is something where we can really dig a little bit deeper and create some understanding. And a good catalyst is, of course, your iridium oxide. That is no longer to be debated here. It is also clear that this is nanostructured. It is not so clear that this is iridium oxide. This is why I put the question mark there. The catalyst gives a stable contribution to the total overpotential. Also, that is something that is not usually the case. When you look in the operation regime of such an electrolyzer, then you see that the catalyst has a significant contribution. If you increase the current density, then you also see that the catalyst is not perfect. The degradation of the system is, you would say, from academic reasons, it's perfect, 30 millivolts per month in dynamical operation. But what is interesting is that the degradation is much faster if you do static operation of such an electrolyzer. We use electrolyzers of a couple of kilowatts of power, and we started them for a couple of thousand hours. So this is not something for 24 hours on a rotating disk electrode experiment where you get this data from. And this indicates to us that there's materials dynamics in the play, and this calls for in-depth analysis. And that was also the motivation why we started about 7 years ago with looking much deeper into what is this iridium oxide. This is just an experiment where one can see this. What you see on the x-axis is the current density, and on the y-axis, the potential. And one sees the different contributions. So the light blue one is the catalyst itself. Then the catalyst with its catalyst layer, so with its contact, is the dark blue part. And you see the membrane. The membrane is one of the weakest things, by the way, anyway, when you look into degradation studies, because these membranes are not so stable as one would think. And even the current collector hardware also contributes to the potential drop. And one sees there is a significant contribution of ohmic things, and there is the catalyst itself, and this is much less than what you would expect from just an ohmic contribution of a non-conducting system. That is also understandable because we know that iridium oxide or iridium metal both are metals. So chemical spectroscopy, what we do now, first we would like to know what's the chemical constitution of the material that you actually use in a catalyst. And so iridium oxide in inverted commas is, after synthesis, a mixture of a so-called black material and iridium metal. It's not iridium dioxide. And the reason for that is deep into the chemistry of iridium, because iridium does not precipitate from an aqueous solution, but it only forms a solid by disproportionation. Almost all other metals in the periodic table, they really form a compound with OH, for example, or with water, and then do a polymerization reaction under the liberation of water. But iridium does not do this. This only forms by disproportionation. That means you get something that is lower in oxidation state and something that is higher in oxidation state. And that is the reason why you get this binary system. And that is also the reason why all iridium materials that you make are core shell structures, where you have a metal in the core and some undefined material in the shell. This already by itself is a strong hint to the suitability of a water splitter, because if it doesn't polymerize and form a polymer material as an oxide, then you can also learn that the ligand field of water and of OH minus is too weak with respect to more complex species, for example, nitrite, chloride, or perchlorate, or organic anions. And that is a very good sign, because the interaction between iridium and oxygen is very weak. Now, some experiments that you can really see this, if you precipitate this iridium black, that is also commercially used to make the electrodes, then one finds, if one reduces that with hydrogen to iridium metal, that this iridium oxide is reduced at very low temperatures, between 50 and 100 degrees Celsius. And what you see in this red box is, that would be iridium oxide. Iridium oxide by itself, if you make it, you can make it by calcination, then you can also see its reducibility. And the material that you use in the electrolyzer cancer is way easier reduced than iridium oxide. That's the first indication that the material is somehow different. Now, when you look at the chemical constitution, and for that you need to do a series of analytical experiments, then you find that the material of choice is a mixed material with a strange average oxidation state of 3.5. And then you see if you go to other conditions of precipitation, then you get something where you approach iridium dioxide, so to higher oxidation states. But this is interesting because if you go to formally higher oxidation states, then you find from analysis that the contribution of metal is increasing. This is because of this disproportionation reaction. But this is not always considered by people who actually do the synthesis of this material, that if you try to attempt decomposition iridium dioxide, then you get a maximum of iridium metal and a minimum of iridium dioxide. And you have to do high temperature calcination in order to get rid of the iridium metal. So what one can also see if one looks into the operation of such a system with electron microscopy, then one finds that the successful catalyst indeed consists of nanoparticles. You see it is about 3-4 nanometer particles. And one sees the lattice image of the iridium oxide, so that is perfectly fine. But after operation, you find this cloudy stuff that in this image you see on top of it. And you see also that there is the impression there are some holes in this cloudy stuff because there are these dark spots in it. If you change now the imaging conditions in your microscope, and you have to be extremely careful to be able to do that because this cloudy stuff is extremely beam sensitive. And if you just focus the beam on it, then you see another iridium metal. And this is also sometimes you find in the literature the result, which is perfectly okay. After some electron irradiation, then you find iridium metal on top of iridium oxide. And this is a beam effect. That is not the true constitution. The true constitution is this quasi-molecular system. And one sees in this 7 angstrom little circle there, one sees the constitution of the iridium atoms. And that is something that the crystallographer knows immediately. That is the typical motif of a hollandite structure. But there is not hollandite, because hollandite is a beautiful crystal. This is just a molecular analog of hollandite. You can do this also by diffraction. And when you do this by electron diffraction, then you find something which is also interesting. Iridium oxide in its rutile form should, of course, only have corner sharing iridium oxygen polyhedra. But in the successful catalytic material, you find quite a bit of edge sharing polyhedra. And that is an indication that this is certainly not only rutile. And of course, we can do then a structural analysis, and then one finds indeed there is a mixture of this rutile and of this hollandite structure. But again, don't be misled. This does not mean that there's a crystal of hollandite in this material. You can, of course, synthesize hollandite and test it, and it's a lousy electrocatalyst in this form. But why is this interesting to detect this as a molecular species? Because this makes it very easy that you change the oxidation state of iridium between 3+ and 4+. As this is not a metal, you, of course, if you change the oxidation state, then you have also to change the coordination of the system. And that is done most conveniently if you change the mixture between edge and corner sharing octahedra, because that's an easy and mobile interaction between several polyhedra if this does not form a crystal, but if it's this kind of oligomeric cluster or molecular species, however you want to call this. And we think this is a very important property of the working surface. So we could say that the well-working system of iridium oxide has something that we in accumulator science you would call a solid electrolyte interface. And the solid electrolyte interface is also consists of this octahedra, like you have them in rutile, but they have a much more loose connectivity. And the looseness of the connectivity is given by OH and water that is coordinated to the system. That is probably the SEI interface of the lithium oxide active electrocatalyst. Now, what's the oxidation state of iridium? That is also an interesting question, in particular, if you look at this black material, because if it's a mixture, then of course, the oxidation state does not exist. This is always a mixture. And that one finds also what I show you here is the performance in blue to the bottom, and one sees, depending on how you have prepared your iridium oxide, you get quite different performances. You can also see that performance and lifetime are well connected to each other. That is also normal in electrocatalysis. That is not something special. But if you do the standard photo emission analysis in order to determine what is the oxidation state, and then you would expect that there is a difference, the good and the bad catalyst should be electronically different in their structure, but the difference is extremely small between iridium 3.75 and iridium 3.882. This is a very small difference. Now, when you look at the analysis of this iridium oxide, this iridium for F photo emission spectra, then you find there's a lot of contributions, and I have no time to go into that. This is not simple, and this is absolutely not straightforward, because iridium as a metal has a different shape of core level lines than iridium oxide, and this iridium oxide induces a satellite structure that is has not been considered by quite a few early analysis of the photo emission spectrum. And unfortunately, it is the case that the chemical shift of iridium 3 plus is not at the expected position, but overlaps very strongly with the satellites from the iridium 4 plus. That is the reason why it is not easy to analyze these asymmetric lines that you get from working catalysts. I have no time to go into that. If you want to discuss this any further, then we can do this maybe in the question and answer section. So now a short deviation on how do we do actually these experiments. So as I said, it is very useful to do this in operando, because we learned that this SEI is quite fragile and it contains a lot of species. And if you don't do this in operando experiments, you might be misled what is the real composition of the SEI. So synchrotron photo emission, of course, is a useful tool that is now very well understood and has been and is being practiced also by other people who occur on this conference here. But there are some challenges that one has to overcome, and this was the reason why it took us about 7 years until we could come to successful measurements. There is something like a pressure gap also in electrochemistry, and if there is not sufficient electrolyte there, then you cannot pass enough current through the system, and if you can't pass enough current through the system, then you cannot see the full evolution of this non-equilibrium state that I mentioned in my introduction. So if you do this with two small currents in the limit of very little conversion, then you might be misled what is the true chemical nature of the SEI. And then, of course, like in the electron microscope, also in the photo emission experiments, there is a massive problem of beam damage and radiolysis. And that is also something that I would like to point out here to the synchrotron users. The idea that for operando experiments, you need super brilliant beamlines, this is not always useful, because sometimes you create your system by the brilliance of your synchrotron beam rather than you study the system that you're really interested in. And there's the problem of information depths. Of course, it is much easier to do synchrotron experiments with high energy X-rays, because then also the radiolysis problem is not so large. But the disadvantage that you have is that you lose the surface sensitivity. And as we have seen in the chemical analysis, that all these, at least this iridium electrocatalysts, they are very delicate core shell structures. One has to be very careful. Do you now analyze the average of the whole thing, or do you analyze more the bulk of the material, or do you really analyze the interfacial system that you are actually interested in? That means the reaction environment in which you do your operando experiment is critical, and one operando experiment and another operando experiment in different reaction environments, even if it's the same system, might give you different answers. So when you see these distinctions in the literature that people disagree, possibly what is the nature of this SEI, this can well be simply a consequence of that they use different reaction environments. Now, how do we do our experiments? We use, of course, our high pressure analyzer. This is this golden part. By now, everybody knows how that works, and I do not need to go into that. Then, of course, you need a light source. This is this green part, and then you need your electrochemical cell. And everything has to come together pretty close in order to be able that it works. That means this is a matter of a millimeter or less distance, and that gives you also a limitation to what kind of operando experiments you can do. There are many suggestions in the literature that you should do multiple operando experiments, and you should look with several spectroscopy simultaneously. spontaneously to that, but when you then really think about on what is necessary in order to perform the electrocatalysis experiment, then you find that your spatial accessibility of the area that you study actually is very limited, and I have to be very careful with the suggestions that you should do multiple operando experiments simultaneously, because then you very easily compromise the reaction environment. This is a quick look how that looks in reality at our synchrotron. All of you who do such experiments have seen this. The interesting thing is that you have a synchrotron experiment and there's a cylinder of liquid water there that you pump, and that is something that, of course, a standard UHV scientist would never do. Now, another representation of that, we understand a little bit better what it means, what a pressure gap is. This is a very nice representation that I stole from Juan Velasco, who is in our team. And what you see is the planet Earth and this very tiny overlayer, which is the atmosphere. And then when we look into the height, the pressure dependence as a function of height over our planet, then we can get a quite nice feeling of what do we do actually when we do an operando experiment. So under vacuum conditions, where one normally does solar emission, then you would find yourself a couple of hundred kilometers above our planet. And then, of course, you can think, what do you learn on our planet if you are, say, at the ISS, and then you look outside and you know this is not exactly very characteristic of what happens at the ground of our planet. Now, what we do is with the instrument that I showed you before, we come then into, say, the stratosphere, so about 1 millibar pressure, but then you're still in the area where high-flying airplanes are flying, and you know as well you cannot survive even in that area. But that is the experiment that we normally would do. And then if we are very careful, then we can go to higher energies, and you will get talks also later in the conference on this kind of technique. And then you come a little bit closer to reality, but you're still far away from the ground of the Earth. So one has to be extremely careful when one does such operando experiments, as I say, that you do a reaction environment in which you, at least under kinetic conditions, you can say you have liquid water in the system and you pass a current through the electrolyte and you have all ions of the electrolyte present, and only then you can expect that you actually really see what you want to see. And the techniques with which we probe our systems, they are extremely invasive with respect to the reality that we are interested in. I have here a little list of what are the different techniques that are at the moment being used. You know them very well. You have them also again here in the conference. There's the very famous dip and pull technique, which is simple to do, but which has this disadvantage that your liquid is open to vacuum. You do not know whether you have really a steady state under these conditions. And of course, you have the salt formation and all kinds of other things that are an overlay over the reaction you're interested in. Then, of course, there is the graphene-covered holy silicon nitride membrane, so with the holes where you look with your system through holes of the electrode. That has the advantage, correct electrolyte, and it is perfectly surface sensitive. But this window technique is very, very critical, and you have lots of beam damage errors. And then locally, you have an evaporation of the electrolyte through a little hole. And then, of course, what you see in your spectrometer is not the one that is in your sample, but there where there is the hole. And this is, of course, something different. Then what we also brought into operation is the PEM as a support, where you put the catalyst on top of the PEM as in a real electrolyzer. And then you put this into vacuum, and I show a little bit more in detail how that works. That is easy to use, but it has also the disadvantage that in reality, there's no liquid water present, it's only water vapor. And water vapor is not exactly an electrolyte. And then it was only necessary to put a lid on top of the whole system. And when you do this, then you might, maybe you can approach the real system. But this is a very delicate experiment, and it is not easy to do. So this is the standard, as I say, early pioneering work from many people, where you see the working electrode, for example, of iridium, and you see an electron micrograph where you see the nanoparticles as before, and you see the gaps in between. This is what people call mud crack type of electrode. That is perfectly fine. But unfortunately, we have to discover that there where we do actually our experiment at the interface, there is no liquid water, there's only water vapor, and this is a serious disadvantage. The consequence also of that is that we find some transformation of material here, for example, also platinum, and we found that the platinum was slightly oxidized, it formed a surface oxide, and at the time we thought, surface oxide is then the true nature of our electrode, and this was nicely reversible with potential, but it turns out this is only the beginning of the transformation. This is not the whole story. So just a short excursion to that. As we studied this extensively with platinum, and platinum is of course a reference material in electrocatalysis, I show you only one slide on that. As a function of potential, when you now apply a real liquid water layer on this, the redox state of the electrode changes instantaneously and drastically. And of course, any post-mortem finds only platinum metal and confirms the noble character of the metal, because unfortunately, the thing is fully reversible and only seen in under operation conditions. Now, I summarize this here. You see in this box B, you see a potential change in the operando experiment. In the box number A, you see the response of the total oxygen that we measure. And one sees as the potential increases, you come to OAR conditions, the amount of oxygen densifies enormously at the interface. So that means that there is a lot of oxygen there and there's also water. You have the impression it's really compressed at the interface. Now, when you see, is this only, does that something change in the electrolyte, or is there also a change in the platinum metal? Then one sees there's a drastic change, because at open circuit potential, you see in the platinum 4F, it's platinum metal, as you would expect, everything fine. Then when you put it a couple of minutes under OAR conditions, then you get this green spectrum. And this is a very clear indication from an hydrated platinum oxide that is not PTO2, this is PTOOH2, that is something different. And then when you switch off the potential and go to open circuit potential, as fast as you can measure a spectrum, which is a couple of seconds, the thing goes back to platinum metal. And you see the blue spectrum is indistinguishable from the red spectrum. So if you would take it out, you would never find that there's platinum oxide. You would say, as you expect, as a chemist, platinum is noble, so it doesn't change under reaction conditions. But unfortunately, it does. Now, when we return now to our iridium, then of course we know already there is a coexistence of metallic and oxidic iridium, and then we found at the beginning, okay, we find in our operando experiments the same, so we would be happy and say, yes, this core shell particle survives under reaction conditions. But we ask ourselves, of course, after some time, how correct was the assignment, and where are the protons in the picture? And then we identify an interesting species. This is this oxygen minus one. By now, I do not need to introduce this anymore. I think you have this all now on the screen. But the interesting question that we asked ourselves, is this really part of the reaction, or is this a sidetrack, or is this maybe a salt formation? So is this something that does happen, but is not related to the kinetics? I only give you a short indication what you see if you take this reaction environment in which you have only water vapor as an electrolyte. Then one sees indeed, yeah, there is an oxidation, and one sees this coexistence of iridium 3 plus 4 plus and iridium metal. That is fine. You see also the massive change in the oxygen KH spectrum. It gets much larger, and it gets also a quite different pre-H feature. That is because you see the oxygen minus one occurring. And whenever this oxygen minus one occurs, one sees also in the mass spectrometer there's oxygen formation. So that is somehow related. This we can easily verify. You can also verify that that is reversible. This is now a three electrode cell, so you have now a proper potential scale, not as we had only a two electrode cell at the beginning. And then we find indeed, yes, this oxygen minus one, this gives this broad small feature that you see in the data, is dependent on the potential that we apply, is reversible. If you switch off the potential, it goes away immediately. So we would say, okay, it is related to it, fine. But what we were not convinced about is the width of this line, because this is a very broad and diffuse line, and we were not sure whether this broadness and diffuseness is correct with what we would have actually expected. Because there are many oxygen species in this system. So, and this is makes it a bit awkward to actually analyze this. So there's of course lattice oxygen, yes. There's water as a reagent, there is water as a solvation species, which is not necessarily the same as liquid water. There's of course OH as a ligand, and there is OH as a reactant. Again, these are two different species. And there is also oxygen in this terminal form in various oxidation states, so this oxyl species. And that, for example, is of course, as we all know, not a constituent element of the iridium oxide structure. So that requires the structural transformation that you get this actually in. And then there's, you have this pressure gap, and then you ask yourself, are these species dependent on the pressure gap or not, or is the contribution of the species dependent on the pressure gap that you have? I illustrate this here with iridium oxide. The middle panel is actually the oxygen KH spectrum simply of liquid water. This is good to know, this is our reference. Now, if you take now this iridium oxide and measure it, then you see, oh, it's quite different from water. Yeah, okay, that you would expect. This is fine. And it has a distinct, very nice pH feature that also has been discussed in the literature by now extensively. But if you take this iridium oxide and put it now in contact with the electrolyte and measure it, then this is the top spectrum, then you see, oh, there's a significant change. So it is not sufficient to say this is iridium oxide or iridium oxyhydroxide and you measure it in vacuum and then say you understand what are the oxygen species that are present. No, they do change as soon as they see liquid water. And now here is just reanalysis of what I have shown in the experimental slides, and these colorful fits that you see, they come from theory now. We have now the chance to do theoretical calculations where we would expect the different species, and then line up very nicely. So we would say there's a very good agreement between, say, computational spectroscopy on one side and experiments on the other side. And that is, of course, absolutely necessary when you see this whole zoo of species that are present. And unfortunately, it is as complicated as it looks here. The question that we have is it now really necessary to put liquid water into the system? And the answer is yes, it is absolutely necessary. And an approximation to liquid water as the electrolyte is giving you wrong answers or incomplete answers. So what is the real active form of this iridium oxide? The active form is, of course, not really iridium oxide, but this iridium oxyhydroxide. And in collaboration with the Max Planck Institute in Stuttgart and Bettina Lodge's team, we were able to make such material to measure its properties. This is a very nice layered material, and you can change the redox state by the same mechanism that I introduced to you with this hollandite. By changing the interlayer hydrogen that you have there, then you break up the interlayer order and you have essentially isolated layers of this material, and they can then have any kind of oxidation state between 3+ and 4+, depending on the protonation or deprotonation reaction. The spectroscopic response of that is very little. One has to be careful in order to see this protonation effect in photo emission. This is not easily detected when you look at the oxidation state change. This is given essentially by this complicated issue with the satellite structure that I introduced. But the electronic structure that comes from theory, again, is showing you big changes when you go from a package of layers to a single layer, and when you go from a protonated to a deprotonated form. Protonated and deprotonated stands here for oxidized or reduced, because when you take, this is always meant by proton plus electron and proton plus electron in or out. And one sees that this changes from essentially a metal to a semiconductor backward and forward. And the only way to discriminate this is the degree of protonation of this terminal oxygen. And that fortunately is very well accessible by the oxygen KH spectrum that you see in this panel B. And one sees just by watching it, the spectrum, you see already whether this is protonated or deprotonated now, because we had all the computational spectroscopy support. If we would have not had that, it would be very difficult to analyze these data. So now when we put now liquid water into the system, then we can see what happens. This is now a cartoon that shows in proximity what we do. So we have a real electrolyte, we have this iridium on the polymer, then we put a graphene lid on top of it, and this polymer electrolyte allows now to have confined layer of liquid water. And this confined layer of liquid water is not only water, but it contains all the ions of the electrolyte. And we have looked and verified that all the ions that are in the electrolyte are permeable through the PM and really accumulate into this confined layer of water. I have almost no time to go through that. When you look into panel B of this slide, this is the photo emission spectrum that you get from the system. And what I only want to show you is this very tiny peak at around 535 electron volts. This is the contribution of the confined liquid layer of water. So this is a very small contribution to all the many oxygen species. And unfortunately, you would have said, okay, more pressure helps more. This is what you see in panel C. That is not true, because as I said, you have to be very close in your experimental arrangement between the cell and the detector, because you have the attenuation of the photoelectrons from the gas phase. And if you increase the pressure in the gas phase, then you get more liquid water, then the attenuation of the electrons is way surpassing the effect that you have more water in the system and get a better electrochemical response. So this is a highly to be optimized system. And we found this back pressure of 1 to 2 millibars is the optimum, where we have high sensitivity, we have still liquid water, and we can still detect proper spectra. So does it really work? Yes, it does work. I have to hurry up a little bit. It's interesting to see that such an electrode system really produces very small amounts of oxygen, but we can very well detect it. You see the potential in the middle, you see the current response in green and the mass spectrometer response in red, and you would say, yes, this really works. This is now a working electrochemical system, and we can assure that the system is actually doing what we want, so we can study it carefully. So this is what we do now very quickly, is we see what is going to happen when we go from open circuit potential to OAR. And then you all know that there is a redox wave before we come to this point. This is at about 1.25 volts. This is this yellow panel that you find in our spectra. And at the beginning, everything is fine. You have a transition from iridium metal to iridium oxide that happens around 0.8 or 0.9 volts. And there is no special oxygen species, everything is as you would expect it. But and when you come to this 1.25 volts, then you see initially that there is the occurrence of these two extra features that come from the deprotonated terminal oxygen species. And this is the first indication that the active centers for. And again, without having the computational spectroscopy at hand, we would not be able to assign this. We would not know that the higher energy species is from mu2, so from bridging oxygen that is protonated or deprotonated, and that the 528 is the terminal oxyl species. And what is also without computational spectroscopy not obvious to one, that there is a huge change in the position of the lines if you protonate or deprotonate the hydrogen. Again, this is a very large expected. Normally the spectroscopist would have said, oh, that doesn't make a big difference. Oh, it does make a very big difference. And again, and I praise this here, without theory, no way that we would have anticipated that. So what happens during the reaction? We do this now in operando. And as you have now seen, the OKH is the real thing to look at. And what we need to study here is the question, what happens with the OKH when we really actually do the reaction? So in the top trace, you see the current that is flowing through the system as a function of potential on the x-axis. And then we do not typical spectroscopy, but we just stand at one of the binding energies where we have either the protonated or the deprotonated forms in B and C. And then we follow what happens to the intensity of these lines when the current increases. And you see very clearly that there's an agreement between these things. So we have a very good operando experimental evidence that if the current is flowing, then we see the deprotonation of this mu1 and this mu2 species. And we see what we would have expected, that the mu2 species is first deprotonated, but this is not very efficient, and the mu1 species is the one that really does it. So that's indicated here. Now comes a long debate, which I have no time to go into, about what is the oxidation state of this. This is a complicated debate, because there is a strong hybridization between iridium and oxygen that you know very well by now. And if this would be a normal metal and not so heavy in the periodic table, then of course this iridium oxygen single bond would not exist, but this would be an iridium oxygen double bond, which is iridyl, and there is titanyl, for example, chromyl, ferryl. The 3D elements all make these double bonds, but iridium doesn't do this. Iridium actually just shares the so-called Hall state, or the oxidation of the oxygen by forming this radical species. The chemist has no problems with assigning this. He calls it tautomery. And so tautomeric forms are very well known in many parts of chemistry. But of course, this is something which is a little bit unusual, because normally that doesn't exist in a material that you can fill into bottles. This is only something that is happening during reactions. But as I say, chemists have no problems with this tautomerism, but of course physicists might be a little bit surprised what that is. So Hall states. And the distribution has been debated a lot and is possibly still debated here. I think this is a difficult thing if you really have to debate this very extensively, because there's a strong hybridization, and this is one of the key reasons why iridium is so good, because of this hybridization. And the hybridization, of course, changes when you do the oxidation reaction, but it does not fall apart. So now comes this word, is this now electrocatalysis or is this not? And this is the question, what comes first? Comes first the iridium oxygen species that is nucleophilic, that is oxidizing, or is it really necessary to apply the potential that the reaction at the water occurs and the iridium oxygen species is simply, as I said, is a spectator species. And we think this is not the case. What happens if you apply a potential to the system, then of course you begin to oxidize this iridium oxyhydroxide or hollandite phase, however you want to call it. The SEI is being oxidized. And if you oxidize the SEI, you create active sites. And these active sites become more dense in number as soon as you reach the potential that deprotonates the whole system, because then you go to the higher oxidation state. And as soon as you go to the higher oxidation state, whatever that is, iridium 4 plus delta, then you reach the nucleophilicity that attacks actually water molecules. So the potential-induced oxygen evolution reaction occurs through a surface chemical process with a rate proportional to the number density of active sites created through the activation potential. And that is exactly the same what happens if you take a chemocatalyst, a normal heterogeneous catalyst, and heat it. This is at room temperature, doesn't do anything because there are no active sites. And first you have to heat the whole system that the active sites are being formed, and then you get a reaction. So this is, of course, our standard theory, how the reaction works. And you have two, to the chemist, unknown things. So what is the star, actually? And we have now a good indication that this is this deprotonated iridium OOH, which has this possibility to change the coordination between edge and corner sharing octahedra. And what is OATS? OATS is probably this oxo species minus one, deprotonated. You can do lots of experiments to verify, again, that this is directly related between the occurrence of this oxidized or deprotonated form is correlated to the OAR activity. And this is not a spectator and this is not a poison. It's really the system that actually does the reaction. And here I just want to point out that this is an interesting methodology, how one can directly verify this by doing these potentiodynamic experiments where you do these pulses and you can see how the spectroscopic response really mimics exactly the potential change that you actually apply to it. So one sees there is a causality between these things. And of course, you can again apply theory to that. And many thanks to this theory people who were able to do all this. And one sees there's a very nice qualitative agreement. One sees it, of course, first this mu2 species, so the bridging oxygen is deprotonated that we would expect because it has a higher stability. And then comes this tautomeric form that people call mu1 oxygen. And the mu1 oxygen is the one that really does the breaking of the water molecules, because that is the nucleophilic form. Now we bring this to a final picture, and this is now, it's very primitive, but I think it shows exactly what is important in this reaction. So we have learned we have an iridium oxo species, and this the oxidation state, as I said, is somewhere between 3 and 4, and there are many reasons to be careful to say what is the exact number, because this is a core shell material. There's always iridium metal present that makes an error in this. And of course, there is this question, what is the protonation or deprotonation form of this iridium oxo species? And that is, so to speak, our active sites. Then you do oxidation, so you apply a potential. And then you have a debate that is either iridium 5 plus oxo double bond, which doesn't exist with these heavy metals, or it is this oxyl species. And what one can, of course, say, it is a mixture of the two. So that means the oxidation, the corrosive potential that you apply, this 1.5 volts, is actually shared by the two atoms, so by the central atom and by the ligand. And that is something that is untypical, because normally if you put such an oxidizing potential to the system, then it's of course the transition metal that takes the burden. So that is being oxidized and the ligand stays always the same. And here we have the situation that we have a so-called non-innocent ligand. That means the ligand contributes to the redox property and not only the transition metal atom. And that is something which is very special in this iridium oxo system. So this probably is our active species that we have from theory. And then we do normal chemistry. This is extremely corrosive, the system. It forms this peroxide, and this hydroperoxide species is still quite corrosive. That is also the reason why you have, for example, the deactivation of burning holes into organic membranes that you have in the system, because there's always a little bit escape of this peroxide species. But you want to get, of course, if possible, as quickly as possible, get rid of the whole system. That happens by the last part of it. But the critical step is indeed this red one, this oxo-oxyl species, and that gives you an explanation why iridium is so good, because it has this possibility to share the burden of this highly corrosive potential between the transition metal and the ligand itself. So this is something that is not occurring very often in chemistry. Final slide. What do we learn from all of this? The chemical constitution of iridium dioxide is way more complex than rutile or hollandite. So this approximation, there's a crystal structure of iridium oxide, and that is actually our catalyst. This is an approximation that is good and necessary for modeling, but the real system that is working is a little bit more complex because it has all these additional oxygen species and it needs dynamic structural flexibility. So theory captured the sequence of reactions, of course, very well, without, however, showing the chemical realization of the catalyst. And what operando really contributes is now what is the atomistic realization of this active science. The chemical dynamics of the iridium is induced by sharing of the corrosive power of the oxidation potential in the terminal iridium oxygen bonds. That is the secret of the whole thing. As good as a metal can do this innocent, non-innocent ligand play, as good actually is this as an electrocatalyst. This is no structural element, so the sharing of the corrosion potential is no structural element of iridium oxide as rutile, nor of the iridium OOH, but only of the hollandite motif, because you need this polyhedra exchange. So the active state forms during reaction. Protonation regulates the current flow. Also, that is an interesting feature. You can make now a nice analogy to cobalt species, because in cobalt species, you have this similar thing, or in the manganese cluster that does it in the green leaf, that also has exactly the same properties. It has also this possibility to do this polyhedra sharing, and that is a critical issue here. So the easy structural switch between layers of octahedra and molecular species of the iridium ortho acid is the secret of the stable high performance operation. And this is so easy for iridium, because iridium in the language of chemistry is a very soft ion. That means it's very large, it has a diffuse electron shell, and by changing the local coordination, the energy of the system doesn't change very much. If you go now to harder metals like ruthenium or to cobalt, then you cannot switch so easily the polyhedra, and then the disproportionation reaction disappears, and then you have polymerization or depolymerization reactions. And this is actually not what you want, because the depolymerization of the electrode leads to dissolution, or you get recrystallization into an insulating oxide with a wide band gap semiconductor. That is also not what you want. And iridium, because of the softness, doesn't do this, because it does this deproportionation reaction. Or in other terms, as we have tried to illustrate this, the unique property of the good catalyst is actually that you can really interpenetrate the states between the ligand and the metal. When you do the potential drop and you get this corrosive potential, then the system does not respond by changing its constitution, but it really does change its hybridization, and this hybridization just shares the burden. So this yellow part that you see in the OER part of this is the secret of it. And however you can make this possible, then you get a good electrocatalyst, but unfortunately nature limits this quite a bit, because as I said, this 1.5 volt is extremely corrosive, and there are not many chemical bonds that withstand 1.5 volts. My final slide is, I would like to thank you for your attention. Albert Einstein said, there is no fundamental law requiring simplicity in natural processes. That means you would say, Schlutl, this was very complicated. Why do we make it? Can't it be simpler? No, it can't be simpler. It is as complicated as it is. And I found it appropriate to say with Leonardo da Vinci, knowledge is the daughter of experience. So it is a good idea to do a real operando experiment and then draw the conclusions. What is the nature of the catalyst, rather than to make a picture first and try then to verify that your picture is correct. You better first look how complicated that is in reality. Thanks a lot for your kind attention. And I stop sharing the screen.
Thank you very much. I clap for everybody. I see Simone and Maria Laura are clapping as well. So now the stage is open for questions. So is anyone, please type in the Q&A or raise your hand if you want to ask a question. So I will start myself. So do we have to understand this as a truly dynamic state? So these octahedra change their coordination during, even at constant potential.
Yes, I think this is the case, because this possibility, as I say, allows to form this terminal oxo species, and this terminal oxo species, they can take this role as deprotonated non-innocent ligands. So they take part of the oxidation power, this O minus one.
So is this in a sense liquid, this structure?
Oh, that is a very good question. I don't know. I would say it is definitely not crystalline. It is not in a translational, it has no translational symmetry. Of course, when you think liquid is something that is in time dynamical, so it changes with time, then one has to think about what is dynamics. Of course, if there's no potential there, then it probably recrystallizes, and that is also the reason why it deactivates. But if you have a potential gradient, then it behaves like a liquid, but this is not dynamical, because dynamics is fluctuation without an external potential. Okay. And I think whether this fluctuates without an external potential, I'm not sure.
Okay. And just to be sure I understood correctly, so even the crystalline form of the oxyhydroxide is not active, or not as active as the...
It's only the defects. You get always a minimum activity, because there's nothing that is free of defects.
Okay.
But in the ideal case, also, for example, we have done this years ago with Peter Strasser. So when you take iridium oxide and go through a calcination series and make it more and more crystalline, then you find that the catalyst gets worse and worse. So when you approximate this to a perfect crystal, then you would say the OER activity of crystalline iridium oxide is zero.
Okay, thank you. So I see in the meantime, people have started raising their hands. So Axel Gross would like to ask a question, please.
Yeah, thank you very much, Robert, for this very nice talk. I have a very general question with respect to the oxidation numbers, because we have also dealt with oxidation numbers in electrode materials. The very concept of oxidation numbers, of course, is a very well-funded concept in chemistry. But as a quantum chemist, I have problems with integer charge numbers. So if you talk of non-integer oxidation states, do you mean then a mixture of different parts with integer oxidation states, or is the whole concept of non-integer or only integer quantum oxidation states? Should we revise that?
This would be now a chemistry conference, probably I would be shot down for what I'm saying now, because this is a constant debate in between chemistry ever since chemistry has introduced this concept. Mm-hmm. I would say I would follow you and say oxidation states are just an ordering principle of chemistry, and the physical meaning of oxidation state is rather limited. Okay. So when you really, as a spectroscopist, when I try to measure this, I have no oxidation state spectrometer, that doesn't exist. Mm-hmm. So you assign certain spectroscopic properties to formal oxidation states. And if you are correct, then you would also say formal oxidation states. Mm-hmm. And formal oxidation states are integers, of course, because it's only not half electrons, there are electrons. Mm-hmm. But of course, electrons, as I said, are shared between bonds, yeah. What we call non-innocent ligand. And at that moment, the concept loses its meaning completely, because if you share it between two atoms, then you have to find out how you divide it. And then this is a problem of crystallography. And whenever you do, whatever you try to measure the electron density between atoms, you always find finite electron density there. Yeah. This idea of an integer oxidation state is an idealization of chemistry. It's a beautiful ordering concept, but it's not worth the debate.
Yeah, I mean, when we want to calculate, then of course we have to put a sphere somewhere, and then where does the anion or cation start and the other one ends, and there's no fixed rule for that. So that's why we also can't give integer numbers at all. Yeah, okay.
Like crystallographers also do, they do it the same way. And of course, every crystallographer has its preference. Is this the minimum, or is it the half of the bond or whatever? And then you get different oxidation states. Yeah, this is an ordering concept and not a physical reality.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. There is now a question by Karina Faber. So please, you can unmute yourself.
Yes, hello. So first, thank you very much for this really nice presentation. It's just a short question to if you could give the reference of the most relevant publications on that topic from your group so that we can read in detail.
If you go, the last year's Nature paper has all the references that we have ever published on this. So from there, you'll find them all.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. Now there is a question. Please also say your affiliation. There is a question by Navid Hagmoradi. So please unmute yourself and say your affiliation.
Thank you so much, Professor. Can you hear me?
Yes, very well.
Yeah, thank you so much. You used the operant analysis to kind of analyze the performance of your electrocatalyst, you know, your conventional electrocatalyst, and says that different oxidation states and composition of maybe crystalline structures can give different performance. Can we use this operant analysis in this a kind of a special synthesis procedures to produce a highly active iridium oxide instead of synthesizing it and after that analyzing which one is better?
Yeah, you raise a very good question. This is, what is the practical use of all of this? And of course, the practical use is you can now make synthetic approaches, for example, use alloys or put the iridium into some other oxidic matrix and use spectroscopy to look for the signature of this oxo species or oxyl species, the ability of a system to get deprotonated. This is the one that you need. And we use this also as an indicator for successful synthesis strategies. And what you also need to learn is from the operando experiment is the single atom iridium catalyst that people sometimes try to advocate is most likely not going to work because you need this polyhedra change thing. And if you have this polyhedra exchange experiment between different elements, then one will find immediately, as I said, that the propensity to form a polycondensation or depolymerization reaction is higher than this redox change disproportionation reaction. Both can be measured, and you can make one synthetic experiment, then you can find, does it have this property? As I said, you look at the oxygen KH, and then you can see whether you find the right features of that, and if it doesn't have this feature, then you don't need to continue that.
Thank you so much. I'm sorry, I forgot to tell my affiliation. I'm from Sabancı University, from Turkey.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. So now Simone Piccinin.
Simone Piccinin from Trieste. The question I have is regarding this layer of hollandite molecular units that we have at the solid liquid interface. So do we know whether this is metallic or not? And if it is not metallic, does it contribute significantly to the overpotential that you measure?
Of course, this is now an interpretation that is very difficult to answer because the metallicity of the system depends on the degree of deprotonation. From the calculations, you have seen that the gap opens and closes whether you are protonated or deprotonated. And of course, now it is an interesting question. Is this always deprotonated or is this dynamical? And this is only a feeling. I would say it tries not to be deprotonated. That means it is mostly metallic, but it becomes then a semiconductor at the moment when it performs the reaction, and then it falls back into a metallic state. This is my interpretation of it. But this is Schlügel's meaning. There's no evidence for that. The point is, this question, whether this is metallic or non-metallic, really depends on at what time resolution do you look at it. It's given by the deprotonation. And I would guess in average it is metallic because this is low, much lower in energy if it's deprotonated. But as it is fluctuating, sometimes it's terminal and then it deprotonates because there's the potential. Then there's the reaction falls back into the metallic state, and this is the resting state of the system. That is would be my answer.
And can we assign a thickness to this, let's call it amorphous layer?
Yeah, about 2 unit cell thicknesses, so half a nanometer. Or a nanometer. Okay. Don't make it too accurate. So this is
Sure.
But it is significantly smaller than the particle size of the iridium system that you have. It's really, it is a core shell system.
Thanks.
Thank you. So, yeah, yes, please, Michiel.
Yes, this is really a challenge for calculation, I can see. I have a question. Is any of this visible in photometry or in impedance spectroscopy?
Yeah, one can do that. So in impedance spectroscopy, I think one can see this, but of course one has to be aware that there are so many parts also contributing to that.
Yeah.
And in time-resolved experiments, at least we could not see this because the time resolution is given essentially by the exchange of the electrolyte and the oxygen bubbles and all these things. And if you run this in the limit of very low conversion, then you would not have all these transport issues, then you do not see this very well. You really need high conversion. I mean, I do not give it a chance that this is time resolution is probably not a good way of looking at it, but impedance spectroscopy does show such phenomena and should show this, but I'm not an expert good enough to say what do we really need to do to really decipher this.
Because it vaguely reminded me of what Michael Lyons always has been saying in Ireland, right? And that was all based on impedance spectroscopy.
Yeah, the problem with impedance spectroscopy is of course the model. So how do you get all the components out of it?
And certainly impossible for a theorist.
Also for an experimentalist, this is really difficult.
Thank you.
Thank you. So last chance, if you have a question or a comment. So I see no further questions. So let's thank Robert Schlögl again for the wonderful talk. And thank you very much. And we reconvene at 2 p.m. Trieste time. So
take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Bye-bye. Thank you.